Good evening. Hi.
Might want to turn your sound down. Is that what I hear?
Yeah. Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Well, I don't want to start recording yet. So no one gets out alive, and the pressure that comes upon the church is to refine and define us. We have opportunities to see where we're doing well, where we're not doing so well, and at what point we break underneath the pressure. It's really important that we don't break under pressure, but most of us will at some point, and God will use that to make us stronger and tougher yet. But if there's no pressure, there is no passion. I tell you that because if you want an easy go in life, just go with the flow. Just go with the flow. Just fit in, belong, do all the things everybody does. Be popular, and you won't have any pressure, and you won't have any passion. And so you have to decide about what that means. Tonight we're going to talk about the church in Pergamum, and I'd like to read it first from my Bible, and again, I'm using the New King James Version, so if this isn't your version, it's okay, but this is a strong message, and I think we need to hear it, and it's not an easy message to hear, to be really honest with you tonight. Let's make sure nobody's in the waiting room. Okay. It says, and this is a chapter 2 of Revelation, and it's verse 12, 2:12. It says, and to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things says he who has the two-edged sword. I know your works and where you dwell, where Satan's throne is, and you hold fast to my name and did not deny my faith, even in the days in which Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was killed among you where Satan dwells. But I have a few things against you, because you have there those who hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat the things sacrificed to idols and to commit sexual immorality. Thus, you also have those who hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, the thing which I hate. Repent, or else I will come to you quickly, and I will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give him some of the hidden manna to eat, and I will give him a white stone, and on the stone a new name, written, which no one knows except him who receives it. And so that's the message to Pergamos. Interesting, isn't it? He has a few corrections to make there. What was going on in Pergamos that made life so challenging for the church? Hey, welcome. Let's see where I want to start here. Pergamum was one of the few cities to which Rome had been given the right to the sword. They had the power to inflict capital punishment. And so it's interesting that in this part, Jesus talks in combat terms, which you think of him as being this Prince of Peace. And he's talking about the sword in his mouth. And he's talking about punishment. And so it's like he's a soldier ready for combat in this part. The church in Pergamum was living in the midst of a fierce battle. Although it may have been intensified in the city, It is the same battle waged in every city of the world then and now. This is probably one of the most important messages for us today in the church, because many of the problems they were having there that we have here, we have the same ones in many ways. Pastor John R.W. Stott, a British pastor, captures the situation in Pergamum when he writes, "Here a pitched battle was being fought in which the soldiers were not men, but ideas. The church in Pergamum, like the church in Rome and Stockholm, Washington and Manila, New Delhi and Los Angeles, was actually engaged in the battle for their minds." And that's the battle we're actually engaged in ourselves, is the battle for our mind. We know that that's true, because when Jesus is going to come to fight the battle, he's going to come to fight with his two-edged sword in his mouth. It's going to be a battle of words and ideas and thoughts. It's not a battle of horses and chariots and bombs and whatever. It's a battle for your mind. And I think anybody who's alive today knows there's a real battle going on for our minds. Many people today, we don't even know what to believe right now. It's such a confusing time, but the battle's for your mind. I think it's really important to note that as targeted as Christians may feel sometimes, like there's this battle going on and Satan wants to destroy us, the battle, in fact, is not about us. It's actually a battle about Jesus. Satan wants to destroy the work of God in the land, and he wants any markers of creation of God taken off the earth. And we're just pawns. It's kind of like what happens to me. My enemy does not get that close to me. He doesn't get to hurt me that much. So guess what he does? He attacks all the people around me. I don't care if you like President Trump or not, but it's a great example that when people can't get to him, they target all the people around them. His wife, his children, people on staff, people that are close. And it's a picture, it's an illustration of what happens to us, is that it's often the enemy would love to get to Jesus, but he can't touch Jesus. So he goes after his kids. He goes after his bride. He goes after those who serve the Lord with their whole heart. Who would that be? That's us. The enemy comes after us, not for our harm, but for his. And so the battle for the mind was being waged on two fronts. The first is ideas that conflict with the revelation in Jesus Christ. So the ideas from the culture bombard the church and tell us what we're supposed to believe. And those things are contrary to the word of God. But there's a pressure from the outside for the church to give in and to go along with. And if you, and that's true today, wouldn't you say? Because many of the ideas that we get from the world, they have infiltrated the church and many people in trying to acquiesce and trying to get along and fit into the world, go along with those ideas. And it makes us very lukewarm kind of Christians, that we'll just go along with everything to keep the peace and all that stuff. That's the war that's going on from without. But there's also the pressure and the war going on from within. Because ideas that conflict with God's revelation in Jesus are pressuring the church from inside. And if you want to test this, bring up any topic you want to, and you'll see a church divided on that topic. I don't care what the topic is. We're so divided now, and we sit in our churches together, but there's things we can't talk about. Right? I mean, if we talk about some of the things we want to talk about, half the church will leave, and then what'll happen? It's divided. And the Bible's very clear. A house divided against itself won't stand. What about a nation divided against itself? Will it stand? What about a church divided against itself? Will it stand? How about a family divided against itself? It won't stand. And what about a person divided against themselves when their heart is fighting with their mind? We are divided. The brain says yay and the heart says no. Right? Have you ever had that kind of battle going on?
Every 10 minutes.
You're really having a rough life if you're having every 10 minutes. Well, you know, we call it cognitive dissonance is when the brain is fighting with the heart. The heart's emotionally saying, yes, give the poor man the $50 in your purse, even though you're starving. And the brain says, no, he's probably making a lot more money than you are. Right? The heart and the mind are fighting. And we fight with ourselves over a lot of things. We really do. There's a lot that goes on inside of us. So standing against overt pressure, the pressure from without, is sometimes much easier than dealing with the pressure from within. But the pressure from without tells us how we will deal with the pressure within. How we deal with that. Can anybody think of ways that you can see the pressure from without influencing the church and the pressure within? Not being able to meet together, having the world tell us when we can get together and how many of us can meet and what that's going to look like. Right? That's pretty tough.
But it's not stopping our church. We still do the same thing every single Sunday. So,
well,
he's not winning in that aspect of us still.
Barna research shows that more people are watching your church than have ever gone to your church before. So the gospel is actually being preached in a much bigger way than it was before. But the pressure from without telling us we can't do that is very difficult. Can anyone else think of any other ideas of pressure that comes from without that tells us what we're supposed to believe within? Media is very powerful. It tells us who we're supposed to vote for. It tells us who the popular kids are in the room. It tells us who's doing the right thing. It depends on the channel you watch as to what kind of media you get, but the media is very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're supposed to be very, very afraid.
Yeah.
Are people online able to hear the comments from people in this room?
No. Not very well. Not very well.
Not very well. So people in the room, I don't have a microphone, which is my bad. I should have had one. So if you're speaking, you have to speak really loud. And you can get within 6 feet of me if you want.
I can add a comment on that pressure.
Yeah.
And it's the pressure of trying to be a good Christian in a very turbulent world where there are so many conflicting ideas of what is right and wrong on race and how to address it and how to speak to it and how to be a good Christian. It's, you know, you're afraid to speak. And basically what we're hearing from a lot of church leaders is just listen and understand, which is good.
Mm-hmm.
But you wonder, is there ever a time that we should also try to help with words of, you know, what we think Christ is trying to say?
Mm-hmm. Good point that you make there, Bruce. I think people are very confused on the racism topic because you can't hardly say anything right. Whatever you say can be taken wrong. I'll give you an example. I have a good friend who is a Black woman from Africa. She and I were talking and I said something to the effect of, oh, I didn't notice that. And she goes, Teresa, the thing about I love about you is you don't seem to see color at all. And I thought, well, that's a nice compliment. Thank you very much. It was probably a couple months later, I had a Black woman in my office for for counseling, and she made a comment to me. She said, "The problem with you, Teresa, is you don't see color at all." And I went, that was not a compliment. But it was the same words.
Right. Yeah.
But it was not a compliment that time. And I was like, so is that a good thing to say or not a good thing to say? I really was kind of confused. Well, she's right. I hardly notice if people are different colors or whatever. I just don't really notice that kind of stuff. Well, it was very offensive to a Black person who's trying to say, we need to be noticed. People need to notice what's happening to us and how we're being treated differently than white people. And white people don't get that. And it's like, oh, okay, so I need you to teach me more about that. I need to listen, right? And learn more about what that means. And so she was able to define it for me from her point of view. And it was actually quite helpful for me. But you, is it the right thing to say? I don't know. I've not said it because of that. I just, are you nay or yay? I don't know. So race is a tough one. It depends on who you're talking to and what their motivation is for what it is you're saying.
It's not just Black to white, it's white to Black. You know, there's, it seems like the focus.
Talk really loud.
The focus has been on the white population against the Black population, but there's a Black population against a white population. There's just a lot of racial stuff that goes in all directions.
One of the problems is that before, and I'm going to say something that don't take this wrong for Pete's sakes, because somebody would get mad at this statement, but I'm going to make it anyway because I never noticed a race problem in the United States before we had a Black president. I was thrilled to have a Black president. I thought it was great that President Obama had been elected. I didn't know him. I didn't even know what he believed. But I thought it was time for us to be open and have diversity because we're a very diverse culture, a very diverse. So I thought that was great, but it did bring more notice to a problem that we weren't noticing before. Now that can be good because we can correct problems we haven't seen before, right? That could be good. What's happening now, I don't think it's so good. I'll just be honest with you people on here, and you can judge me later. But the destruction of the cities, of the businesses, has hurt me. It's really been difficult for me to see the message of what's happening to the Black culture in the midst of watching cities be destroyed downtown, beautiful, beautiful cities like Seattle, and I mean, lovely. And now they kind of have streets, whole blocks that look like third world countries. And that's a loud statement, but I'm not sure it's the one they meant to give. So that's just my opinion. I don't like the distraction. I do think the message is important. I think we need to be listening to the pain and to the messages. I think they're important, but so you can see with me, I kind of stand on both sides of the fence right there. My liberal friends think I'm too conservative, and my conservative friends think I'm too liberal. But okay. Honestly, we're all wrestling, aren't we? A little bit.
Yeah.
Same.
When you say something,
then
people think, oh, she must be.
I wish we didn't have such labels, honestly. If we didn't have those labels, I think we would be handling this much better. I just do. I think the labels hurt us. Oh, must be a liberal. Must be a conservative. Mm-hmm. Yeah. God knows the situation. He's watching the church in the whole country. God's watching the church. He's standing in the midst of us. Now, what is he seeing? What kind of correction would he be making in the church today, I wonder?
I mean,
he's watching us.
Are we bold enough?
Are we bold enough? That's an interesting question, isn't it? Well, Pergamum was in the midst of a fierce battle, that's for sure. And honestly, when you're in the middle of a battle that's for the mind, it's hard to define what the battle is. You can't see it with your hands. You can't see it in front of you. They're just ideas that conflict with God's revelation. The situation in Pergamum was kind of a Christian veneer. Like, things looked really godly and righteous on the outside. But the pressure was mounting on the inside. And the United States is a lot like that. We kind of call this a Christian nation, or we did call it a Christian nation. And I think that makes it sometimes harder to deal with things. It's not black and white. It's not cut and dried, right? There's no middle ground. So looking at the dynamics of the battle for the mind helps us to understand the battle we're in for our minds. Jesus says, lays out his assessment of the city of Pergamum. He would not have been popular with the Chamber of Commerce, that's for sure, or City Council of Supervisors. I know where you dwell, he says, where Satan has his throne. Isn't that interesting? I know where you dwell. You dwell where Satan has his throne. Why did he say that? Why did he say Satan is enthroned in your city? That's kind of an interesting thing. Well, Pergamum was built on a very high rock. It was, if you will, perched on a rock throne. It was famous for its magnificent libraries, which at the time of Jesus, there were over 200,000 parchment scrolls. And the city was enamored with new ideas, new thoughts, and they were consumed with words and the meaning of words. Yeah, they didn't have Google, but they studied. Okay, but it was the throne of Satan. Well, it was the capital city of the Roman province of Asia. Pergamum was the center of Caesar worship. As early as 29 BC, the city sought and won permission to build the first temple in honor of Caesar Augustus, which meant that Pergamum was the emperor cult and it held power over people's minds. And that's why Jesus talks about it the way that he does. Behind the city, rising 1,000 feet above it, was a huge conical hill. On the hill stood a whole host of temples and altars. Two temples were the most dominant. One was dedicated to the worship of Asclepius, who was thought to be the god of healing. You might find this interesting. The symbol for the Bruce, do you know that word, Asclepius?
No, I don't.
Okay. Well, it's the symbol of the serpent. And the serpent in that time was a symbol for healing. Does that ring a bell with anybody?
Yeah. Yes.
That's Epidaurus. That's the home of the medical
symbol. It's the medical symbol. Mm-hmm. So here's the deal. They used snakes for healing back then. Mm-hmm. And people would sit all night in the temple. And they would wait for the snake to come and heal them. And if they were touched by the serpent, they were certain to be healed. And so that's where we get our symbol of medicine in the United States, comes from that. It was a symbol of healing, and it still is a symbol of healing today, if you look at symbols of healing. It represents the evil one who seeks to seduce people away from the living God and away from the only one who really knows how to heal and had a history of healing, was God himself. He's the healer. But in Pergamum, they looked to the serpent to heal them. Thought that was kind of interesting. The other dominant temple was the honor of Zeus. Anybody remember Zeus? The Greek god. Zeus the Savior. right? The altar of Zeus was built on a ledge, jutting out from the hillside 800 feet above the street. The platform on the ledge was 20 feet high and 90 feet square. This temple dominated the city, and every person in Pergamum lived in the shadow of its altar. Maybe that's why Jesus speaks the way he does. To a people who are constantly in the shadow of superstition. So beliefs were interesting. In every way, Pergamum was the center for ideas that blinded people to the truth about God, about the world, and about themselves. What's that?
Just like the media today.
Just like the media today.
A lot of information. It's just
bombarded with information that's conflicting with each other, depending on your channels. You can go one channel to another. You will get exact opposite information. You'll have to struggle to decide who you're going to believe. And I just really encourage you not to really believe it at all, because you need to do your own research and find facts. In this day and age, you almost can't believe what you're being fed. So the one Jesus called the deceiver had the mind of a whole city, from politics to medicine to religion. And so there was a church in that city. The fact that there even was a church in that city is probably a great testimony to the power of the gospel, because it wasn't popular to be a Christian. And it's becoming very unpopular in this country to be a Christian right now. Maybe you've noticed. I don't know. Has anyone noticed that? There's a lot of anti-Christ sentiments. Mm-hmm. You know, we're hearing now about tear down all the Christian idols because it's the white people's God. Now, if that doesn't offend black people, I don't know what will, because that's the most offensive thing I've heard toward black people. There are many black Christian people who are powerful men and women of God. Mm-hmm. To call it a white God, the white people's God, is offensive to white people, for one thing. But really, it should be offensive to black people, because it's not the truth. And so it's interesting that they're talking about tearing down all those idols now. You know, God had some powerful things to say about this church in Pergamum. While the Christians of Pergamum were resisting the influence from without, they were carelessly indifferent to the influence from within. When we look at the news and we see people want to tear down the idols of Christianity, or they want to come against something of the church, it's easy for us to combat that stuff, because we can see it. We can see, well, that's not Christ. They're not Christians. They don't know him. And so we don't expect them to know him and act like they do. So we can fight that. The struggle we have right now in the body of Christ is the messages we get from within the church. Because the topics we can't talk about outside the church, we also now cannot talk about from the inside of the church either. Anybody think of one in particular that is kind of taboo for us to talk about?
Yeah. Really
sexuality.
So any sexuality
can't be talked about. We're almost schizophrenic in the United States. You can have sex with anybody, anything, anytime, but we can't talk about it ever. What is that? We need to be talking about this. We need to be talking about what's happening in the world of sexuality, because it's one of those spots that we can't talk about, and we need to be learning about it. It's one of the things Jesus condemned in the city of Pergamum. It wasn't just the thought of the day, it was also the activity of the day that he had a problem with. And people probably called him intolerant. They called him intolerant. Do you think Jesus was intolerant?
No.
Then you would be wrong. He was so intolerant, it was ridiculous. He called sin, sin. And he said there were things that are considered sin. And if you did those things, he'd tell you need to repent. Get your heart right with God. He had no tolerance for the Nicolaitans. He had no tolerance for certain things. And he said, the fact that you tolerate some of these things is something I'm going to deal with. I was like, ooh, I told you this was going to be a little bit of a bitey type message tonight. It might hurt a little bit. It might be a little bitey because there are things that God wants to talk about, and he talked to the church at Pergamum about. We call tolerance in our day, we say that it's a great virtue, right? Mm-hmm. They're just not tolerant, especially on moral and religious matters. Here, Jesus presents himself as passionately intolerant because he loves the truth. He is the truth. He speaks the truth, and he demands the truth. He likes the truth. And because, as he claims elsewhere, falsehood and deception of any kind enslaves people. We become enslaved to the lies. Jesus is passionately intolerant because he's passionately intolerant of his people being slaves or enslaved by the wrong thought. He's grieved when people are imprisoned by illness or poverty or oppression, but what grieves him most is people who are imprisoned by false ideas and lies. False presuppositions about the world, about God, about ourselves. He's especially intolerant of false ideas being taught and perpetrated in his name. So he calls for the church in Pergamum to repent of its careless tolerance. He says, only the truth can set us free. Only the truth can set us free. Are you tolerant? Do you tolerate everything? I think we've all kind of learned to tolerate a lot of things.
Only when you have to.
Only when you have to.
You know, I mean, like the mask.
The mask.
Mm-hmm. That's a good example right there. That, you know, most of us have to tolerate that.
Mm-hmm.
Do we want to? I don't. But just to keep the peace, I will.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm asked.
Well, whenever you go in a public place, you have to wear a mask now, and some people don't tolerate that very well. However, it doesn't really go against a Christian conviction. You're not going to go to hell if you wear or do not wear a mask.
Right.
I just want to make that clear tonight. Okay. This is not a matter of salvation if you do or do not wear a mask. However, if you're going to go in certain stores and they demand that you wear a mask, you get to decide, do I wear a mask or do I go in the store? There's other stores. Well, not anymore. Everybody has to wear a mask in the state of Oregon now. But it's a different type of tolerance, though. It doesn't go against our Christian convictions. It isn't in the word as a sin. It's not going to hurt us. Tolerance is something that we do when something goes against what we believe is true and right, and we don't say anything, and we just allow it because everybody's allowing it, nobody's speaking about it, so we can't talk about it. That's tolerance. That's,
and we're told that's like a godly thing.
And we're told that it's keeping the peace. And I think that we make a huge mistake with the idea that we have to keep the peace. We're making a huge mistake. Do you know that even though we're called to be peacemakers, that Jesus himself did not come to bring peace on earth? Does that surprise anybody? That he didn't come to bring peace? Anybody want to fight with me about that? I mean, it's an interesting topic. We find that in Matthew 10. Matthew 10, verse 34. It says, Matthew 10, 34 tells us, I do not think that I came to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but I came with a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes will be those of his own household. He who loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves his son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who finds his life will lose it, but he will who loses his life for my name's sake will find it. Did not come to bring peace, came with a sword. Have you thought of Jesus as a peacemaker who came to unite all of us? And you know, if you really read the God Gospels, reading the red, you don't find Jesus being a peacemaker. He upset everybody and everything everywhere he went, so much that they tried to kill him repeatedly because he kept taking people off their strong stands. About the time they thought they had him figured out, he said something else. They had rules and laws. They were righteous and they were religious. They knew what was supposed to take place, what wasn't supposed to take place, and Jesus came and undid all of it every time they turn around. Because he was the truth. And that is the truth. That is the truth. He was the truth. And he always upsets things. And if you are not finding yourself upsetting people periodically and overturning the tables in your world, you probably aren't probably taking a stand for much. You're probably going along with the flow and tolerating things that even you don't agree or believe in. Would you say that's true? Mm-hmm. Is that true about you? I have a habit of making people mad periodically. It's too often, but I don't mean to. It's just there's truth. And truth compromised is a conviction of mine. I can't compromise. But I do have a soft spot for certain people and certain things that would probably surprise a lot of people. It's not tolerance. It's opportunity. For instance, I have drag queens in counseling. Now, I will tell you, I'm not in agreement with the lifestyle of drag queens. I just want to say that. Please don't be offended if you're a drag queen. Just know that I take opportunity for the drag queen to come in to counseling so that I can learn the story and they can learn the truth. Because there's no hope for them if we're not available. There's no hope if we can't speak truth into their life. And I can't speak truth into their life until I know the truth of their life first. And so I learned their story, the whole thing, where this began, where this belief started, what began to happen, how this started. And you wouldn't believe the stories that I hear. It'd probably curl your hair if you heard the stories I hear all the time. But when they leave, they know they've been heard and they've been listened to and they've been cared for, and nobody may have ever heard their story ever before. And they love to come. However, they tend not to stay the same over time. They change. God is changing them by his spirit. He's healing their bodies. He's healing their minds. He's setting them free and he's teaching them the truth. Truth that maybe they've never heard before in their whole life. I have great compassion for people who've never heard the truth. I think it's because I was a child in the world without God and I never knew the truth. And when I started learning the truth and it started transforming my mind, it blew me away. It's like there is a truth. There is right and wrong. There is good and bad, and it's written and I can bank on it. I know the truth now. There's a lot of freedom. But for a child who knew no truth, the world's a scary place. There's no boundaries. There's no righteous or wrongness. It's just trying to figure things out. The truth is an anchor, right? It anchors us and tells us that we have a plumb line. And the plumb line of truth saves us and keeps us safe. Like I know where to measure myself against. And it's not someone else's opinion. There's a plumb line. It's written in red. I can go find the truth, just about anything, in the Bible. And it's never going to change. And I love that. That's safety to me. I haven't always liked the truth. It's not always set well with me. The first time the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, you have to be forgiven, you have to forgive, I went into panic mode. I was like, what? What do you mean to be forgiven, I have to forgive? Then the Holy Spirit said, you have to forgive your father. I think I'd just rather die and go to hell, is exactly what I told God at that time. That's not going to happen in this lifetime because of how stubborn I am and how little I understood about forgiveness. That took 7 years to accomplish. But God accomplished it. What I love about that is that I had someone in counseling, I don't know, a few months back, and I said, you're going to have to forgive your father. And I was able to share my story of forgiving my father and what that took for me. And by the time he left, I said, I took 7 years. If I were you, I wouldn't even take 7 minutes. It's going to happen, so just do it. Just hang it up, because there's no future in fighting with God about this. But he and I had a great talk about it. And I said, the miracle of forgiveness was that I could get out of the way and God could work. And I didn't know that till I got out of the way and let him work. And then God does things much better than we do. I was out of bondage by forgiving. The truth was I had to forgive. There are people in the body of Christ who do not believe you have to forgive people who've hurt you if they've hurt you bad enough. It's like, okay, we have to forgive that, and you can forgive that. But that thing, that's really a big one. I don't think you can forgive that person who raped your daughter. I don't think you can forgive that person who shot up the grocery store and your husband was buying milk. I don't think you have to forgive this person. This person's sin is way too big to be forgiving. And that's the lie that the body of Christ has bought. If you don't forgive, you will not be forgiven, is a truth. And it's not an easy truth. It's not a fun truth, especially for people who have been offended and hurt in such powerful ways all their life. It didn't make sense. But I will tell you, it's a powerful, powerful tool in the hand of God.
That brings to mind, you know, what we were talking about earlier. It's part of the hard thing about trying to understand the race issue in some ways. You know, just like the subject of reparations.
Yeah.
Is that a way to forgive, or is that a mistake? Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. The problem in that one is that you're not talking to Christians, you're talking to a culture. But when you talk to Christians, you have the opportunity to share that part, you know. Yeah. But it's not something we're hearing a lot of today, is you've got to forgive. You've got to forgive. These are not options.
There are lots of Christians, you know, I guess we have to define that broadly. But, you know, in different denominations and so forth, and they're right out there on the leading edge of a lot of the, you know, movements that we have to sort of discern our way through.
Yeah, it's true. So if this was a battle for the minds of the people, what were they teaching there, do you think? They were teaching that it was okay for Christians to eat meat that was sacrificed to idols. Now, sacrificed food to idols was more than just food. Back in other cultures, and even in other cultures today, sitting down and having food with somebody is a way of bonding and attaching yourself to them and being accepted into their family. It's not just food you eat. And back then, people would take their meats and they would sacrifice them to their idols, and they would feel like God was invited to the table with them, whatever God it was they sacrificed food to. And there were many Christians who said, you know, there's no power in their God, so you can eat the sacrificed meat. It's no big deal. And so that's what was going on at that time. It's not a problem. It's not a big deal because we don't recognize that God. So you can eat meat sacrificed to idols. Well, apparently it was a big deal. That the problem wasn't in the meat itself. The problem was in the message that I will share my food with your God. I will sit at the table with your belief. And so that was the problem. And there was another problem. There was meat sacrificed to idols, and it was okay to have sexual intercourse outside the bonds of a marriage between one man and one woman, a life covenant we call marriage. That was one of the biggest problems of their day that they were fighting with. And as we know from the rest of the New Testament, both problems, eating meat sacrificed to idols and sexual immorality, were major issues for the first century Christians. One of the reasons for that is because sex in those days was okay. You know, they had prostitutes if you want to have sex for pleasure, and they had concubines if they wanted to just have sex for daily cohabitation, things like that. And then they had wives for the purpose of having children and to have a faithful guardian over your house. It was common practice. It was not sin to them. It was not sin to them to have
they had multiple wives,
yeah. But they had a lot. Generally, a household would have a wife, and then they would have concubines. And to whoever the husband was, they would have sex with all those people. But even if you wanted just to have sex for pleasure, having the temple prostitutes was okay. It was just a common practice. And that's what it meant when Jesus came and he overturned the tables and he started tearing things up as he came and he said, no, that is not okay. That message actually didn't go over very well with these folks. When something's okay in a culture and we have justified it through many, many means, then for us to have Jesus come and say, go and sin no more. This is not okay. Upsets our apple cart pretty badly. It does. It goes against what we want to say we believe. But in reality, that is a huge problem in our day and age. That is a problem that I think we should talk about. I think pastors should talk about. I think people should talk about more often. I've had people justify sex outside of marriage in every way you can possibly imagine. Elderly people, for instance, have a very good reason for having sex outside of marriage. They had a spouse that died and they are by themselves and they move in with the neighbor lady next door because if they get married, they lose one part of their Social Security and then they can't pay the rent. Right. And so that's a good reason to not get married, right? A good reason to not get married would be we can't afford it. And so we're seeing that among the elderly right now in the churches. And we see it among disabled people as well. People with disabilities, if they have disability, they get so much money for disability. But if they combine their income, then they can't afford their rent because or their health care. And so the costs of getting married are high. And so I've actually had this argument sitting in my office. We can't get married. If we do, we lose part of our disability, then we can't pay the rent. And so we've decided that we are going to tell people we are married, but we're not going to get married. And I said to this couple, the problem with that is that when you get mad and you get tired and you decide it's not working, you'll just walk away from each other. There won't even be a divorce. You'll just go find someone. Oh, no, that will never happen to us. We love each other so much. We would never leave each other. I said, I'm telling you, marriage is not that fun. Marriage is hard work, man. And there are times you're going to get mad and you're not going to want to be married. I'm just going to tell you the truth. Mm-hmm. And in the day that you feel that way, and if you have no bonds of marriage, you will have no anchor for your marriage. Mm-hmm. And you'll find it easy just to walk away in that day. Hey, Timothy, welcome. Timothy's from Senegal. He lives in New York. Spent the afternoon with me today. Oh, Raymond. I called you Timothy. Timothy. Oh, I was thinking of Timothy in Senegal. It's Raymond. Sorry, Raymond. I do know you. I spent the whole day with you for Pete's sakes. Anyway, we're talking about sex, and I knew you wanted to get in on that. The problem for us, though, is that we have lots of reasons we do what we do, and they all make sense. And so we justify ourselves a lot. That very same couple a year later broke up and found other people to live with. So I was right, and it was almost prophetic, but it wasn't a joy to me. I really wanted to see them get married. I think they would have made it if they would have gotten married. But we have lots of reasons for what we do. And so, let's see, formally used. So what's the will of God on the issue of sexuality? What's the will of God on the issue of sexuality? Well, it's written in red. You know, it's written in the Bible what God's expectations are. There is no guessing as to what the expectation of what it means to be in holy matrimony before the Lord. And so it's very troublesome. I've had people in my office that are homosexual and dealing with transgender. I have transgender teenagers in my office talking about what's going on with them. And I have a lot of passion and compassion for people who will come in and talk about, I need help sorting this out. I don't know why I went this direction or whatever. And we sort things out. We talk about everything. I have people in my office, pastors, talking about their addictions to pornography and to masturbating and all the rest of it. We talk about everything. Because the reality is, if we don't grasp the truth, hold the truth, live in the truth, then we will die without it, and we will not fare well in the second death, which is at the judgment. So we're not in judgment right now. We have time to clean things up right now, you know. But once we die, we don't get that. So it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these essentials, that you abstain from things sacrificed to idols, from blood, and from things being strangled, and from sexual immorality. That is what was given in Acts 15. The council laid down what they were saying they would accept as minimal expressions. You're muted, Raymond. If you want to speak, you have to unmute.
Hold on, ma'am. Say that again, ma'am.
Okay. I will say this again. The council laid down what it considered to be the minimum expressions of loyalty to Jesus. And that was a decree that it seemed good to the Holy Spirit to lay upon you no greater burden than this.
True.
To abstain from meat that's been offered to idols, from blood and from things strangled, and to abstain from sexual immorality. And this was very challenging word for them at that time, because they were all used to having sex with the temple prostitutes, the concubines, and having a wife. And so this was not easy. This was difficult news for them.
What does it mean about things strangled? What does that mean?
Animals that were strangled. I know that I don't know what they do to my meat these days, so I can't even tell you. So, but the Balaamites, those who worship Baal, and the Nicolaitans were teaching the exact opposite. They were arguing that it's okay to eat meat sacrificed to idols and give oneself to any sexual practice as long as it didn't hurt anybody else. And so the pressure from without was, it's okay to do this. The pressure from within is, well, some of us kind of do this. And the plumb line is, you can't do this and be okay with God. God calls us into repentance. So there's a lot of fundamental issues that come with this when we come to terms with this stuff in our day and age, right? We misunderstand the very nature of God and the very nature of what it means to be in reality when it comes to sexuality in our culture. We are people who have become so tolerant that we do not even know the truth about sexuality in our culture anymore. For instance, many people will say, it's not okay to be gay. Really, where did you find that information? Where do you find that? Where does it say that? Can anyone tell me where it says that? I can tell you where it says it. I'm just asking if anybody knows.
It's in 1 Corinthians, I forget what chapter, but it's laid out by Paul as one of those bad sins, along with, you know, some other things like lying and theft.
Yeah. It's also in Romans 1. Chapter 1 of Romans is very clear. And I'll just take you there. Because when we have arguments, we have to know where to find our truth. Where do these things come from? Who said we can't? And where does it say it? You have to have a good reason for why you believe what you believe. And when I say I don't believe in it, I tell you the reason I don't believe in it is because God said it was not okay. And he said it in Romans. And he said it, let me see if I can find it. In chapter 1, verse 26, it says, for this reason, God gave them up to vile passions. For even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing that which is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error which was due them. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers. Those of you who get into whispering and backbiting, be really careful. They are backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to their parents. Very important word for this generation. Undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, and knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but approve those who practice them. Therefore, you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are who judge. For in that you judge another, you condemn yourself. So, just thought we'd get that off the table because it's important to know why we believe what we believe. I'm not telling you something popular right now. Is anybody mad yet?
I mean, with the pornography, sex trafficking, and all that just went away.
Well, what happens is the slippery slope. The slippery slope is once you justify one thing, you go to justifying another thing. And if you don't believe me, you look up Man-Boy Love Association and see where pedophiles are now being seen as just a different type of sexual preference. Because that's what's going on.
That's screwed up.
Well, that's a belief system. And what's happening is that the slippery slope we're on as a culture is when you justify one thing, then you have opened the doorway to other things. And I think we have opened a lot of doors in our culture to a lot of things. But this is a really important issue because it seems to have gotten lost. This message of purity and sex inside of marriage has gotten lost in our culture. And the pressure from without is very strong. And the pressure from within is growing very strong as well. Because there's a lot of arguments right now about all this stuff. But the Bible doesn't argue. It just says the truth. And so when we believe something, we have to go back to that plumb line and say, really, where did it say that? Where did it say that?
Yeah. And when people say, and you know, these would be Christians would say, well, that part of Paul is inconsistent. And so I don't believe that little bit. And the problem is, who makes that judgment?
Yeah.
Are you the arbiter of what is true and not in all of God's word?
There, you've got a point there. And that's really the issue, isn't it? Is that who determines the rules?
Yep.
It has to be the word of God. It can't be us. We're too arbitrary.
Yep.
So we are physical creatures. We are living in a physical universe. But we're also spiritual creatures living in a spiritual universe. And in this spiritual universe, there's a battle going on. And every inch is in a battle. There is no neutral territory in us at all. You can't divorce your spirit from your body. You can't say it's okay for my body to do this and it's not going to somehow affect my spirit. We are whole beings. Our whole body, soul, spirit, mind is one thing. Mm-hmm. And so you can't go sleep with your boyfriend in here and leave your spirit out on the porch. Your spirit goes in with you. You know what I'm saying? It's just you're one being, and we're very sexual beings. He created us sexual beings. Sex was his idea. He really likes it. He likes sex because it unifies a man with a woman. It makes them one. It creates a family. It's the plan of God for causing the universe to be filled with people. He loves the whole person. We're not just a spirit being having a physical experience, and we're not a physical being having a spiritual experience. We are both, and it's all in all. We are spiritually physical beings having a physical and spiritual and often sexual experience in our world. You can't divorce one from the other. So you can't know that if you sleep with a prostitute, you become one with the prostitute. How does that happen? Well, I always teach the teenagers about sex by the frosting on the cakes thing. And they seem to like that. They notice that you can't say the cake is actually a good cake without frosting. And frosting is like sex, and the cake is like the relationships. You really got to know what's in those layers of cake before you throw the frosting on there, or you're going to have a mess. And that's the whole point of spending time outside of sex, building relationship. Mm-hmm. So you know who that person is. Because once you put the frosting on, you can't see all the bad stuff, even if there's poison in there.
Maybe just the frosting on it.
What's that? Yeah. If you just eat the frosting, it'll make you sick. And if you just have relationship inside a marriage without frosting, it's kind of boring and there's no flavor and beauty to it either. So we violate the will of God when we use our body contrary to the revealed word of God, what we were created to do. But, you know, understand this, that, you know, we have this whole grace message going on, you know, well, but for the grace of God, you know, God gives grace to this situation. He gives grace to this situation. I just want to say, I don't think we understand grace at all when we say things like that. Consider grace. Consider that when you're in the Old Testament, if you had relationships with a neighbor, then you would be guilty of adultery. That's living under the law. The law says if you have sex with this person, you're guilty of adultery or fornication if you're not married. But under grace, if you look on a woman with lust, you have committed the sin of fornication. God no longer measured just the outside of what people did. He measured their very heart. And he said, if you even look on a woman with lust, you have committed adultery in your heart. Right? Same thing with murder. You know, in the Old Testament, you could almost kill somebody. You could beat them half to death. But if they didn't die, you weren't guilty of anything. If they died, you were guilty of murder. In the New Testament, we live under grace, where it says, if you hate your brother, you have committed murder. You don't even have to tell him. You just think it in your heart. It's done. Grace is much more difficult to live under than the law. The law was easy. You knew when you were doing right, and you knew when you were doing wrong, and it was evident, and it's right here written bold. Now God challenges the heart of man and looks at every single thought that the heart will have, because out of the heart comes the issues of life. If you're jealous in your heart, nobody would know that. But God would know that because he's measuring your heart. He would see that, you know. And so we stand under grace, which is a much more difficult measure of sin than the law. The law actually is easier. And I think that's why people tend to return to the law often and want to just obey the law, because grace is a much harder manifestation to live up to. And I think we should think about that when people say, well, God gives grace for those people, he gives grace for this situation and that one, it's like, oh, you might want to look up what that word means, because I don't think we understand it all together. What are some of your thoughts on that, you guys? Anybody?
I'll speak.
Okay.
I think that the church overdoes it on grace. I mean, your typical church, they don't care if you've slept with someone or not.
No, they don't.
They really don't. It's never preached about chastity or that's just, it's, you never hear about it ever.
No.
So, and it's tough too, you know. In fact, I remember Christianity Today a number of years ago ran an essay, and that's CT is like one of the top evangelical magazine, as to can we really expect people to not sleep together before marriage? And it was a serious essay.
Yeah.
And I remember reading that, I thought all sorts of unprintable things, because I've been writing since I was in since I was 30, books on sexuality and singles, and basically the war that singles have on this whole issue, and how basically the church has walked away from them and has not, certainly does not support any kind of singles who are trying to keep to Jesus' commands, not whatsoever. So anyway, all you hear is grace. You never hear anything else, and it's very, very discouraging.
Well, I think we have to just know the truth, and that the truth sets us free. And if we have the strength to begin to speak and to stand on issues, it would be easier for us. We won't be liked and we won't be popular. Jesus was not liked and he was not popular. And I'm going to tell you that if you're liked and you're popular, there's something wrong with your faith. We are walking the narrow road. We are on a narrow pathway. We are not taking the broad pathway. We are people who will be, we will be people who will be despised and rejected because of what we believe. And if we're not despised and rejected for what we believe, then we're either living in a nice little Christian bubble where everybody believes the same thing together, or we are not speaking at all anywhere and sharing anything different than what other people are. And I think we've compromised so much in the body of Christ. I mean, the biggest struggle they're having in mainstream denominations, starting almost 7 years ago, was, you know, can the homosexual in our church be the pastor?
Mm-hmm. There's a lot.
Well, there's a lot of that. And it's like, so that was something that 25 years ago, you would never even, it never even would have hit the mind of a thought that that could happen. But we have moved in our culture a long way away from our plumb line when it comes to what God will accept and what he will not accept. And that sounds hard, I'm sure, to many people. But there's scriptures about this. So the one who overcomes all these things is the thing I love. You know, he says, I will give you a white stone and a new name written on that stone, which no one knows but the one who receives it. What is that gift? You know what Jesus is really saying here? He's saying, I want intimacy with you. I want an intimate relationship with you. I want you to choose me above everything you want to do. If you want to have dinner with people who have sacrificed me to idols, I'm asking you to choose me instead. Say, no, my God does not approve that. I'm not going to do that. You know, choose me. I want to know you, and I want you to know me. I want intimacy with you. God's calling us into an intimate relationship with him. He's saying, choose me above them. You know, it's an amazing thing what God will do for us and do in us and through us when we obey the word of God and we believe the same truth that he believes. It's an amazing thing. I personally struggled with this message more than probably a lot of people because I grew up having sex. I've had sex since I was about 4 years old. I've never known a life of purity ever. And so for me, when I came into Christ, sex was not a big deal. It was just what you do. I had no in me at all, anywhere. And so the work that had to be done in my life to bring about even the belief that somebody could be pure and righteous, having had sex all their life, was way out there. But the Lord spoke to me one night and he gave me a promise after I became a Christian. And he said, if you will choose me above every man that wants you, and if you'll come to me when you're tempted and choose me and don't have sex before you get married, then I will make your life so pure that you will be so pure that getting married, sex will be like the first time on your wedding night. That he would redeem everything that had been stolen and everything that had happened to me, that he would make it right. On my wedding night, I would marry as a virgin. Nobody can make a promise like that but God. Nobody could do that but God. But that's the intimacy he's calling us into. And I'm sorry if I make you uncomfortable with this sex talk, but I've got to tell you that God has a plan for us. He has a plan for purity and righteousness and restoration and restoring everything that got stolen from us. We didn't know these things. We didn't walk in this truth. But now that we do, there's a promise that goes with it that says, if you'll walk in intimacy with me, I'll walk in intimacy with you. And I'll give back everything that's been stolen, everything. And God has literally done that in my life. He's literally done that. And if he can do that for me, I know he can do that for you. He can do that for anybody. I have a lot of good things to say to people who are stuck, who are caught in all kinds of things they don't think they can get out of. I've got good news. God is a redeemer. He's a restorer. He will give back what the enemy has stolen. He's not judging. There's no judgment yet. He's not judging. This isn't judgment day. And this isn't judgment day, and I'm not God, and so I don't have to judge. All I have to do is share the truth that I know to have intimacy with Christ. And remember what that word intimacy means. It's so important. Into me, see? Jesus is saying, I want you to see into me and see my heart for you and my passion for you and my love for you and my grace and mercy for you. And I want you to see it so much that you'll be drawn to nothing but me. And then you'll take from my hand what I give to you. That if you'll seek me first, seek ye first the kingdom of God, all these things will be added unto you. And how do I know that's true? Because one day there was a man sitting on a riverbank, and the Holy Spirit fell on that man and said, I want you to take Teresa to be your wife. And he said, God, I don't love her like that. And he said, I do. And I'm asking you to take Teresa as your wife. And so when Patrick came to my house and said to me, I think the Lord wants us to get married. I said, you know, I heard that too. I think he does too. We actually had no emotion about it. We weren't excited. We were just obedient. It was just like, well, this is what God wants to do. And he's telling us to get married. So we'll just go get married. A month later, we were married. And you know what? A month later. Yeah. Yeah. It's like, well, God told us to do something. We just went and did it. And you know, that was God giving to me that blessing, that thing that he said, I'm going to restore back everything stolen. You know, we're married 40 years this year. That's astounding. Yeah, congratulations. I mean, it's amazing to be able to say I've been married 40 years. And I've been faithful, and he's been faithful, and we've lived under the blessing hand of God. Because we did what God told us to do. Had I gone after some of the cuter guys in the church, don't tell him this, but Patrick wasn't the cutest guy. I'll just say that. It's just, there were cuter guys in the church. But I knew him. I knew his heart. I knew him well. And I'd led him to the Lord. Oh, yeah, he talks about me. Of course. He knew me when, right? Back in those days. But we grew up together in Christ, and by just doing it Christ's way and not doing my own thing in his name, but waiting and letting God call the shots, I've lived in a really blessed life. Not easy life, not simple life. I don't get the easy stuff. I get thrown in the deep end all the time. But it's the best life I ever could have, and I never could have done it myself. God has good things for those who will not compromise with the messages of this world and will not compromise in what they know to be the truth and will not play the game of trying to be popular and make everybody feel good and make everybody happy. I've determined I may be the last man standing in my life. I may be the only one who agrees with me in the end that God's word is absolutely true and I will only obey it. But I'm willing to do that by myself. Many people have come and gone in my life. Many people have come and gone in my life. But God has always stayed the same. And he's always been faithful. And my desire is to know the truth, to live it out the way God outlined it in the word, in the best way I know how. Isn't that true for all of us, really? Isn't that the truth? We just want to do God's will. We want to be God people. And God likes us. And he's not mad at us. And he's not disappointed in us when we sin. He actually just wants us to get up and keep going. He doesn't hurt us. He doesn't judge us. So anyway, that's our study tonight. How was it? Are you guys all right?
Yep.
Teresa, would you help us with a good, maybe your thought on what grace is? Since we
there's talked
about
off.
It, but we kind of help us with what you think it is, you know, because it can be used so, you know.
Let me just say, Bruce, that we're all worthy of death. That every one of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and we are worthy of death. Every time we sin, we betray Christ. Every time we step out of his will, we betray him. We are the ones who would have had him on that cross.
Mm-hmm.
Every time we do something we know he's telling us not to do, or every time we don't do what he's telling us to do, the grace of God is that he made a provision for us on the cross. He died on the cross for our sin that we could be forgiven. He gave his spirit that we could be totally transformed in the spirit of our mind. He gave us the strength to allow him to do the work he wants to do in us and transform our lives completely and heal us from all the damage we ourselves have done. That's grace. That's amazing. That's amazing grace. Because we're really evil. We all are.
I feel like the father and the child, the mother and the child, how the child's doing stuff, the mother, the father doesn't dislike the child.
Yeah.
Grace.
Parents don't turn on their children when they do wrong. They might smack them around a little bit and get them back on the right track. But they don't take their love off of them. And God has not taken his love off of us. And that is grace. That is mercy.
And I think when we love God in Christ, we have to understand, I guess, that grace is really not, I mean, we hear about inexhaustible grace. And we hear about cheap grace. And I think we've got to come to grips with that, that there is cheap grace, which is false, you know, that's not real grace. It's where we're opportunists. That's a good way to put it. There are opportunists who use grace and take it and turn around and do the same thing again that offends God or hurts God.
But I think it's also grace is that we're on a journey. We're not perfect, and it takes a while to get through things. It took me 7 years to forgive my dad, for instance. You know, that 7 years, God didn't turn away from me and say, boy, Teresa, you're just too much work. It's, you know, you just aren't going to do it. And he had mercy for me, he had grace for me. It took me years to get through lots of different things I've had to go through in my life. I had a lot of healing that had to be done, and it took time. And I was just not perfect, and I wasn't done for a long time. So we have to be kind of careful with defining that area of grace, because in reality, he's not done with us yet.
Right.
That's good. That's good. That's good, because and that's why I asked the subject, you know, how do you see grace? Because it's beautiful, and yet you want to honor it, but you also want to know that
you're not
God is, God is so big that he can forgive.
Oh, God is marvelous. God forgives. This is not even the question. The thing about who we are in him is the miracle. And there's no one I've met yet that has looked at me and said, I made it, I'm done, and God doesn't have anything left to do in my life. I'm just complete in him. I mean, I just don't know who that person is, or I don't know what that would look like. I would just be enamored with that. And so we're all a work in progress. It's not like we're done. And now we can just say we're the epitome of what God was creating. God always is willing to show us our next step. It's the next thing he's working on. That thing that convicts you today, it's just the next thing. You'll get past that one. You'll conquer it. You'll overcome it. He'll show you the next thing that you get to work on now, right?
Yeah. And thank goodness. That's called growth. That's the mustard seed.
I like that, Bruce. Let's close in prayer tonight. We've gone a little bit over. Are you guys all okay?
Yep.
Any assignment?
Pardon?
Any assignment?
Oh, yes, I did have an assignment. Thank you for reminding me about that, Bruce. I want us to really evaluate this week where the pressure comes from when we can't do the right thing or we can't say something is wrong. I want you to watch yourself and see where your personal pressure comes from, because we all have it. We have areas where we can't say certain things. If certain people were in this room tonight, I'm not sure I could say some of the things I said tonight, for instance. You know, why is that? Where's that pressure come from? I want us to identify our own pressure in our life.
When does it, I guess for me, as you say that, I think, where's that line between like correction or like truth and then shame?
Well, right. Shame's a whole nother topic. That would take us quite a while to get through shame. I have a lot on it. But it's actually not, it's when we are ashamed of the gospel and we're ashamed of speaking the truth. That's our plumb line. The gospel and the truth is our plumb line. That's where we return to. If we can't speak it, live it, teach it, identify it, then there's a good chance we're compromising it somewhere in our life. And that's something we got to pay attention to. That's what I really want you paying attention to, is where does the pressure come from in your life? What feels pressurized to you right now in your life? So that's one part. And the second part is that part with grace. That part that Bruce is talking about with grace. And that simply is, do you have enough grace for you? We talk about the grace of God. God has a lot more grace for us than we have for ourselves. Right? We're hard on people. We're hard on ourselves. And God is not. He's not full of condemnation. He's not full of shame. He died to set us free from all those things. So where do you get hung up on your own issues where you don't like you? You don't have the grace to let you grow up. You think you've got to be perfect now. And when you're not, it hurts you. So it's self-evaluation. Is your homework this week? Can everybody do it? Everybody raise your hand if you're going to do your homework this week. Mom, I don't see your hand raised over there. Yeah. There you go. Father God, we thank you so much that you live within us, that you brought us together and you keep teaching us and moving us forward. We don't want to be like the church at Pergamum. We really want to be pleasing to you in all respects. So we're asking for God, you to lead and guide and give us wisdom to move forward in our lives in ways that please you and bless you. We give you all the praise, all the glory for all that we are, because we never could have done this on our own. We could never have come to this place, God, without you. You have saved us from ourselves. So we're praying, Lord God, that you go with each person that came tonight and those who weren't able to make it tonight. We just pray over them and ask a blessing on their life and ask, God, that you do miraculous and mighty things that were promised long beforehand. This is a miraculous day and age we live in. Help us to walk in it. We give you thanks for being here. We thank you for your spirit and your presence in this place. Go with us tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Y'all good? Everybody all right?
Yep.
Everybody have a heartfelt.
Good to see you all.
A heartfelt July 4th.
Oh yeah. And Ray.